let it rain. Good morning. Welcome to the Vineyard. Those that are with us, online, we're glad you could be here today. God is so good. He loves us so much. He will correct us from time to time like he does for all his children. But he loves us beyond belief. And we just want to give back to him. So we encourage you today to be free in your worship, to be thoughtful in your listening to the sermon, and to be open in your heart to receive whatever the Lord has for you today. If you're able to continue standing, please do. If not, just make yourself comfortable. Deserve it, Steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is your faithfulness, O Lord. Great is your faithfulness. Sing it with me. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. They're new. New every morning. They're new every morning. They're new every morning. New every morning. Thank you. They are new every morning. They're new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness.
Perfect in all of your ways. You are.
Heavenly Father, Papa, Dad, but only the best, Abba. I just want to apologize to those of you who've not had a good earthly father, either absent or mean, hurtful. Parents are supposed to be a representation of God to their children. Even the best of us blow it sometimes, but I really apologize to those of you that have gotten a bad impression of what a father is. And I want to remind you that you have a heavenly Father who's none of those bad things. He only wants the very best for you. When he calls you deeper still, it's into his arms of love. So why don't you go flying into those arms today? Trust him. He'll never leave you or forsake you. Never, ever. As you call.
Do I? undeservedly to know your love, Father in me. Father, you're all I need. My soul.
Good morning. How good does it feel to be a child of God? My name is Ray Dayringer. I'm privileged to be on the exec team here, so glad to have everyone here today. If you're a first-time guest, we'd love it if you'd fill out the connection card. It's on the seat back in front of you. Just tell us how you found your way here. You can drop that in the offering basket or over on the information table, and we'll reach out to you if you have a prayer request or something. And for every one of those we get turned in, we're going to donate $10 to the Pontifex Food Outreach. We enjoy partnering with Pontifex to feed the hungry in the community. And if you're joining us from home, you can connect with us at newhopevineyard.org/connect. So go ahead and reach out, and if you have a prayer request, let us know. BKC Kids, you're now released. They're so excited. While they're leaving, a couple other announcements. Good Friday worship and prayer service, April 7th at 7. See how we kept that easy? The 7th at 7, so you can remember the date and the time. There's a theme there. That's why I mentioned that, so you'll see in a minute. Enjoy a casual evening of worship music, praise, and powerful prayer with your New Hope family. So love to see everyone at that. Easter breakfast, April 9th at 9. The 9th at 9. See what we did there? So, invite your family and friends to join us for the breakfast to celebrate Jesus' resurrection. It's always a great time. Overflow Conference, April 21st and 22nd. This is a time for women to be equipped with and empowered in heaven's abundance at Vineyard Northwest in Cincinnati, Ohio. The conference cost is $25 each, or two for $40. The motel cost has not been determined yet. There's going to be more information about that as we get more details. So, before Tony comes up with the message, let's pray over the offering. Dear Lord, you continue just to bless us in every way imaginable, and we just thank you for that, and we just cherish this opportunity to give a portion of that back to use to further your work in the community and to make everybody aware of your love and just show your love in our community. And we bless this offering in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Ray. Good morning, everybody. Good to see you this morning. Good morning, Jay. It's already been a great morning here, hasn't it? Wow. Awesome worship. Thank you, worship team. We just so appreciate you so much. And we are blessed. We've got great worship teams at this church and good worship leaders that just bring their heart as much as they do their talents. And so I feel that we are just really blessed here. And we are finishing our series on I Am Chosen today as we get ready for Palm Sunday next week and into Easter. And we have a really special treat Easter through Pentecost Sunday, we're going to be joining with all of the Vineyard USA, so churches all around America, doing a series based on the Holy Spirit. And what a better way to lead all the way up into Pentecost and talk about how amazing the Holy Spirit is. And it's called Empowered. And we'll be talking about that more as we get closer. But what a wonderful way to bring unity to us as a church, as a bunch of churches, association of churches, a movement, as we like to call it here, in the American Vineyard churches. So very cool. We love that. Look forward to it. The really kind of fun thing about things like this is when you plan things ahead and then the Vineyard sends you stuff and says, hey, we got this for you in case you want it. And the really cool part is at the beginning of the year, I had already been praying about, God, what do you want us to talk about at Easter and maybe the month of April after we're through this chosen thing? And I got, let's do a series on the Holy Spirit. So I planned the 5 weeks of Holy Spirit. And then all of a sudden we get this thing from the Vineyard a few weeks ago. It said, hey, would you guys like to join the Vineyard USA talking about the Holy Spirit? I'm like, why don't you guys just join us? Because we kind of, God already told us in little Fremont, Ohio, we were doing that. So, but what a treat. I love when God moves like that. I don't believe in coincidence. I think God had something planned for us all along. And I just think that's wonderful when that's so affirmed and lines up. So anyway, I am chosen. What a bold statement to talk about. And we get that out of John 15:16, which is actually back on the poster on the back bar there, which not a lot of churches can even say that, right? Welcome to New Hope Vineyard. The words of Jesus himself. You didn't choose me. I chose you. I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit so that the Father will give you whatever you ask for using my name. This was spoken to the original 12 disciples, but it goes on to us as his continuing disciples in the 21st century. Give you whatever you ask for using my name. Well, that's great because I'd like a new car. But what he's talking about here is what we want, what we ask for is when our desires start lining up with the will of God. Our desires start lining up with his desires. And then what he's talking about here, if you go, you know, read this in context, it's to bear fruit, to produce lasting fruit. That should be the desires of our heart. And when that becomes the desires of our heart, then he goes, I'm going to give that to you. So go get him, tiger. Go be bold. Go be confident and share the love of Jesus with somebody today. Because he chose you to do that. He chose us to do that. That's exciting. That's really very exciting. Now, as we read this, you didn't choose me, I chose you. It almost makes us wonder, did I have any choice in this matter? Was I predestined from the dawn of time to be here today and follow God, and I really had no choice in the matter? And maybe some were chosen not to follow him. How does that work? Because that's concerning. But in 2 Peter 3:9, it tells us that God desires that none would perish, but that all would repent and receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior of their lives. And we know that Christianity is not a members-only club. And we should never think of that as that. We are not here to be served, but to serve. And it's for everybody and anybody who would say, I want Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Anyone who would say, I will follow you, Jesus. The only requirement is that we repent, we turn from the wrongdoings that we do, and we receive the free gift of eternal life. And he's already paid for that, right? It's a free gift. Price has already been paid. So are we chosen or do we choose? Well, the context of this scripture, because as we talk about a lot here, context is everything, right? And if we read this, the entire chapter, we're not going to take that time to do that today. Read it when you get home because we got other stuff we want to get to today. But in the context, this is a story of the vine and the branches, if you remember that, where Jesus said, I'm the vine, you are the branches. Abide in me, right? And so we abide in him. We dwell with God. We experience the presence of God and dwell in him daily. Not just Sundays, not just Sunday morning, but daily. And not just daily, but hourly and every minute. We are to dwell in his presence, whether we are here at church or in the Walmarts or in a traffic jam or at work when you're just so frustrated. Let's dwell in the Lord. It changes our perspective where we are. A lot of times we realize that we're in the presence of God. And that's pretty cool. So it tells us that we are chosen when we abide in him, when we dwell in him. So when we know Jesus as our Savior and our Lord, we can say with confidence, I am chosen. And so we can say that with boldness, with confidence. There are a few things in life that we are really confident about, but man, we can look at this and go, you know what? I am confident in this. This is a promise from Jesus himself. I am chosen. Now, over the past few months, we've looked at other crazy statements, wonderful statements of identity, three wonderfully bold proclamations of who we are in Jesus. The first is, I am created in God's image. Then, I am a new creation, redeemed, restored, reconciled. How cool is that? Last week, we looked at, I am loved by a loving Father, like Christopher even talked about this morning. Our Heavenly Father is a loving Father. He's a good, good Father, as we sang. And today we're going to talk about, I am a child of God. We just got done singing that. I am a child of God. What a crazy, wonderful, audacious thing to say. There's no other religion in the world that you can say, I'm God's child. It's the beauty of Christianity, because Christianity is truth. And the truth is that we can be recognized as a child of God. Just not just some follower, not just some servant, not just some person that goes makes sacrifices at a temple or says the right prayer. But we're children of God. We're not perfect. We mess up. We break our Father's heart sometimes. But there's always redemption. There's always renewal. We can always come back to him. I'm a child of God. So if you have your Bible, if you want to turn, otherwise it'll be on the screens in front of you. If you're watching from home, it'll be on your screen. I'm going to read out of Galatians chapter 4, verses 1 through 10. I'll be reading out of the New Living Translation today. If you need a Bible and you don't have one, you can pick one up for free at the Welcome and Information Table. That's our gift, just to say we want you to read the Bible. Go for it. All right? Galatians 4, 1 through 10. Think of it this way. If a father dies and leaves an inheritance for his young children, those children are not much better than the slaves until they grow up, even though they actually own everything the father had. They have to obey their guardians until they reach whatever age the father set. And that's the way it is with us before Christ came. We were like children. We were slaves to our basic spiritual principles of this world. So we were like little children. But when the right time came, God's timing is always right. God sent his son, born of a woman, subject to the law. God sent him to buy freedom for us who were slaves to the law so that he could adopt us as his very own children. He sent his son, born of a woman, subject to the law, to pay the price. We talked about that. Gift of eternal life is free. Well, for us, it's free because God already paid the price, and the price was the blood of his son, Jesus Christ, the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross. So we could be adopted as his children. Now, a more direct translation, the Living Translation is a great translation. It's a wonderful reading translation, but a more accurate translation of the Greek here is we receive adoption to sonship. So does that mean we leave out all the girls and the women here? Absolutely not. Remember, again, we need to always read our Bible in context. And this was written in the first century around the Mediterranean region of to the Galatians, the church in Galatia, modern-day Turkey area. And so here's the thing. To be adopted into sonship, not simply as a child, means that we become heirs. Because in that culture, daughters cannot become heirs. It's not fair, it's not right, and we know that today, but in that culture, that's the way it was. Not even younger boys could become heirs. It had to be the oldest son. And yet God is saying, I've adopted you, both men and women, into sonship so that you could be heirs to the kingdom. It's a wonderfully inclusive statement. So he's not saying I'm excluding the women. He's saying I'm bringing everybody into sonship. You all get the same rights and the same benefits of sonship. And that's pretty cool. It is the result of us coming to know Jesus as our Lord and Savior and following him. We all, you know, we've heard the statement where people have said, well, we're all God's children. Not really. We're all God's creation. And then once we come to know Jesus as our Savior and Lord, once we begin following him, then we're adopted into sonship. We become children of God. But not until then. All right, let's continue with this chapter. And because we are his children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts. I love that. Prompting us to call out, Abba, Father. Now you are no longer slave, but God's own child. And since you are his child, God has made you his heir. We've all dreamed of that time when some dead great uncle leaves us something in his will that we never knew about. And it's like, congratulations, you won the lottery. Your great uncle Josiah, who lived in wherever that you never knew, left you $1 million. Wouldn't that be great? If anybody wants to adopt me, you got $1 million, come see me afterward. This, thank you, Jay. Uncle Jay, wow. This is a better promise. This isn't a promise for $1 million. This is a promise to inherit the kingdom of God, to live in that kingdom daily. Not when we die, today, every day. It's what we in the Vineyard like to call the already and the not yet. See, the not yet's already come through Jesus. So we're already living it. And we're going to live it even more on the other side of heaven. How wonderful is that? We are heirs to the kingdom. So he's talking to a Gentile nation. The Galatians were Gentiles at the time. So they were, in other words, they were not Jewish, is what the word Gentile means. He says, before you Gentiles knew God, you were slaves to so-called gods that do not even exist. So now that you know God, or should I say that God knows you, why do you want to go back again and become slaves once more to the weak and useless spiritual principles of this world? You are trying to earn favor with God by observing certain days or months or seasons of the year. In other words, he's saying, don't go back to the old ways. Now, let's go back a little bit where it says, now that God knows you. God knows you. God knows us individually, intimately, wonderfully. And we need to understand that, you know, we've talked about this before, the language of the Bible, this was written in Greek, has so much deeper and more complex meanings. It's not just, hey, I know you, I met you, we've talked a few times, we had coffee. No. God knows you. He created you. He knitted you together in your mother's womb. He knows every fiber, every strand of DNA, because he made you. He created you. So he knows us even better than we could ever know ourselves. And since he knows us and calls us into sonship, he said, why would we ever go back to our old gods? And we're going, wait a minute. I was born in this church. I was raised here. I don't go to other gods. I wasn't a Buddhist or a Muslim at any time. Grew up in church, or I didn't go to church, and now I am coming to church. when we're talking about other gods here, that we're talking about anything that we put before the one true God, anything that we worship. It could be anything from a TV obsession to gaming, any kind of addiction, social status, past pains that we allow to define us, anything where we devote our time, our thoughts, our energy, our resources, that's what we worship. So is it God, capital G, or is it those little gods, little g? What do we put first in our life? What is our biggest priority in our life? That's what we worship. What consumes our thoughts daily? That's what we worship. And he's saying, don't go back to that. You're free from it. I've broken those bonds. When you come to know Jesus, it says the Spirit lives within us. Why are we going back to the old ways? We are children of God. Verse 7, now you are no longer a slave, but God's own child. We sing that song in church, right? We are no longer slaves to fear. I am a child of God. We sing that often, right? And it comes right from this passage of Scripture. So you learn Scripture while you're singing. That's pretty cool. But that's an amazing declaration, too. I am no longer a slave to fear. We'll talk about fear in a minute and how it can capture us. But I am a child of God. Do you believe it? Okay. Do you believe it? I'm glad. Are you living like you believe it? That's another question, isn't it? Because we can believe all kinds of things. But are we living like we believe this? Are we living that like we can confidently say, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I'm a child of God. Or is this just something that we sing on Sundays and then tomorrow we're so puckered and anxious we can barely move? The song goes on to proclaim, I am surrounded by the arms of the Father. I'm surrounded by songs of deliverance. We've been liberated from our bondage. We are the sons and daughters. Let us sing our freedom. That's like, yes! That's not a head nod. That's like a yeah! That's a hanky-waving, pew-jumping amen statement, guys. That'll work too. If we have Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we are the children of God. We are heirs to the throne, and it doesn't matter what fear the world throws at us. We are no longer slaves to that fear. John 8, where Jesus tells us, you might know this, if the Son sets you free, absolutely, you will be free indeed. Are we living that? Do we believe this? Do we believe that the Son set us free? Or do we believe that, man, I keep praying and praying and God won't answer my prayers? Do we believe he set us free? But free from what? We talked about letting things go, talked about giving up our old gods, we talked about being a slave to fear. So let's look at being free from four specific fears that may just vex us. Just hold us in their grip that you are free from if you are a child of God. First one, the fear of being alone. The fear of being alone. I would do anything to have the perfect man in my life. You know what? Jesus is that perfect man. How about this one? I just need the right woman to complete me. Only the Spirit of God can complete us. Let's get those right first. To be alone is wonderful because, first of all, we're never alone when we have God live in our heart. Matthew 11, 28 tells us this. Then Jesus said, come to me, all you who are weary and carry heavy burdens. I will give you rest. The burden of fear of being alone is not too big for Jesus. Hear me. Because fear, with fear and anxiety in our lives, we can't rest. And Jesus is saying, hey, you got all this stuff. What do we do with it? Come to me, he says. Give it to me. I'll take it. And in exchange, I'm going to give you rest. I'm going to give you freedom so you can breathe at night, so you can rest at night. We're pretty blessed here in this country. We have the ability to rest pretty well at night in a comfy bed that's in a nice warm room or a cooled room during the summer, and we don't have the fear of bombs going off around us. And there are countries in the world where that is a reality today, right now. That's what we're talking about here. There are no more bombs going off around you, spiritually speaking. Rest in me. All right, the fear of being alone. How about the fear of rejection? Oh, man, rejection stinks, right? No one likes to be rejected by others. Sometimes it's hard to take that risk because you're like, what if I'm rejected? We've all been there. No one likes to be rejected. I hate that feeling. That's just an awful feeling. It is disheartening. It's deflating when you give yourself to another in any capacity, whether it's I'm going for a job or I've asked someone out on a date and they've shot me down, whether it's a brother, a mother, a spouse, that any kind of feeling of rejection by the one whom you love, you took that risk, and then you've been rejected. It can hold us back from taking the chances that the Lord wants us to step out in. It holds us back, that fear, from living the life that he's given us. And this leads us to the what if thinking. Well, Lord, you told me to go do that, but what if? And Jesus is saying, okay, I'm here. What if? What if I get rejected? I'll never reject you. What if that person hates me? I'll never hate you, he says. What more do we need? Psalm 27:10 says, even if my father and mother abandon me, the Lord will hold me close. The idea of a loving parent totally rejecting their child's almost unheard of, but our Heavenly Father never rejects, never abandons, never gives up on his children. He always holds us close. So, no rejection, no fear of rejection, because it'll happen, but there's no fear of it. Our confidence is in the Lord, and no fear of being alone, because he's always with us. What about the fear of failure? We are free from the fear of failure. In a culture where success seems to be everything, failure can be a brutal reminder of our own imperfection or our perceived incompetence about ourselves. I'm not good enough. Thomas Edison, while working on the light bulb, said, I have not failed. I've just found 10,000 ways that won't work. What if we kept that attitude? I haven't failed. I've just found 10,000 ways that aren't working yet. But God has me on the right path. I'm still moving forward with what he's got. And the nice thing is, now these 10,000 ways aren't getting in the way of the one he wants us to see. We got him out of the way. Let's concentrate on what we need to do now and move forward. The fear of failure. Jesus said, humanly speaking, it is impossible, but not with God. Everything is possible with God. Hear me? You hear him. Don't listen to me. Listen to Jesus. Everything is possible with God. Yeah, but I got this going on. And everything is possible with God. Yeah, but my friends, really, everything is possible with God. That word everything kind of covers all the excuses, doesn't it? Yikes. Fear of failure. What about being free from the fear of becoming like someone else? I don't want to be like my mother. I don't want to be like my father. I don't want to be like this person. I don't want to be, I took a job as a manager. I don't want to be like my old boss was. Anyone who had some kind of influence on you. I don't want to be like them. Good, you're not. You're you, and God made you exactly who he needed you to be. And you don't need to be like anyone else. You are amazingly, creatively, wonderfully made by a God for a very specific purpose. I love doing puzzles. I know I'm like a 70-year-old, person at a nursing home, but I love doing puzzles. And I've got these great, I usually get the 1,000-piece puzzles. And if I've offended you, sorry, come do a puzzle with me. We'll have fun. I'll buy you a cup of coffee. I love these 1,000-piece puzzles. Some of them are a little easier than others. Some are hard. When my mom was still around, we would exchange puzzles. And my brothers would always go, dude, you're exchanging puzzles with mom. And I'm like, I like doing puzzles. It chills me out. 1,000 pieces. I open that bad boy up, and guess what? There's not a single one that are the same. Even if the colors are the same, the shapes are a little different, so they fit in exactly where the Creator designed them to fit. Are you kind of seeing where I'm going with this? You are created to fit exactly where God needs you to be in his kingdom. And maybe you just haven't realized it yet. So if nobody's told you, I'm telling you right now. Hear that. God has a purpose for you, a greater purpose, a wonderful purpose. And he made you to fit exactly where he needs you to be. I love that. I love that. So you don't have to be like anyone. Why? Because you are a new creation. One of our go-to verses here at the Vineyard, especially when we do baptism, 2 Corinthians 5:17, anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person, a new creation. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. Hallelujah. What an amazing promise. A new creation, not a little better, you're doing okay now. We talked about this a few weeks ago. You're not even going to be like your mother or your father or that bad boss you had or whatever. In fact, you're not even going to be like your old self. You're a new creation in God. Something wonderful happened, and this is a wonderful promise. So no fear, because God has a plan specifically for you. And so hear this today, that there is no fear in the love of Christ. You are a child of God. What do you have to fear? Jesus has called us into freedom through his perfect love, and perfect love casts out all fear. Now, you guys know that the opposite of love is not hate, right? Do you know that? We think of that. What people say an opposite, love, hate. No. Hate's not the opposite of love. Hate is just an ugly, selfish lack of love. The opposite of love is fear. The opposite of love is fear, and perfect love casts out all fear. So don't let fear rule you when God is offering you the exact opposite, perfect love. Not just love, perfect love. A love beyond all human understanding. It just doesn't make sense sometimes when we think about it. How can God love me? You know what? I ask that all the time. How can God love a guy like me? And I'm so glad it's not up to me the way he loves me. Because he loves me in ways I can't even imagine. It does the same for you too. If you're a parent, you know what I'm talking about, because you look at your kids and go, man, they really messed up. I just love them. They got all the crayons out. I told them to put them away. Right now, do I love them? Give me another minute or two, then I'll love them again, right? But it always comes back to that love. Well, they need to earn it, and then I'll love them again. Is that what you say to your kids? No, right? You always love, even when they drive you nuts. There's always that love there, and I love that. And how much more does our Heavenly Father love us? He is a good, good Father. We sang that this morning, right? You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. You are perfect in all your ways. He is a good Father, and we are his children. And as we stated last week, we are loved by a loving Father, heirs to the kingdom with Jesus Christ himself. We are empowered to do greater things by the work of the Holy Spirit dwelling within us. The only thing stopping us is us. I don't know about you, but my worst enemy, well, you're looking at him. A lot of times I just need to get out of my way, right? We're children of God. And I got news for you. A little side note to end up here. Because we're all children of God, you know what that makes us? Family. We're all family together. Welcome. Some of you are like, really? Yes. All of us. And here's the cool thing. Not just us, New Hope Vineyard Church, but us, all the churches in Fremont who know the and love the Lord. Doesn't matter what label's on your building. Are we all in Christ? Yeah. We just went to, some of us went to a conference this weekend, that Kingdom Come conference, which was amazing in Toledo. It wasn't a Vineyard conference. It was a conference of believers from all around this area. And when we sang worship songs, we didn't sing Vineyard songs. We sang songs of worship to God, the Father. We're all family. But let's talk about us right here. We are family. Even the ones you haven't met yet. That, you know what I'm talking about, right? The guy who's across the aisle that you haven't asked his name yet because you're like, I've seen him for the last 12 weeks, but I've been afraid to say, and now I've kind of passed the time of going, hey, I forgot to ask, right? I see him every Sunday, but I don't really know. Let's get to know each other. We're family. So we do what families do. We love one another. I love us. I say it often. I love who we are. I love us. Families care for one another. They hope for one another. And they pray for one another. Families sacrifice for one another. They rejoice with one another, and they cry with one another. We may even hurt one another sometimes. But God has called us to move above that and not hold grudges, but instead to forgive, to forget, and to love each other even more. We are family. And times may get tough, just like every family. But we don't divorce ourselves from the family. Don't leave the family angry. I'm going to take my ball and go home. We adjust. We reconcile. We talk to one another. We sort things out. We resolve issues together. We celebrate together. We mourn together. We hurt together. We rejoice together. Why? We're children of God and we are family. So take a look around right now. Go ahead. That's your family. It's maybe your first time here. Guess who your family is today? For this moment, that's your family. We are family. That's exciting. I'm going to ask the worship team to come up. And if you need prayer today, there will be people right over there and right over there who will pray with you. Whether it's, I need a prayer of healing, I need to come to know Jesus. I hear this Jesus thing. I want to know about him. Maybe it's, I don't know if Jesus is real, but I'd like prayer and go, hey, if you're real, Lord, show me. He's not afraid of the challenge. But I will tell you this, he will show you. So don't be surprised. We're family. We're children of God. We don't go back to our old ways, as tempting as it may be. We live as that new creation in Christ. And we embrace. Let's review real quick these four amazing statements that I just want you to know. I want you to hold them in here and go, I don't care what anyone says about me, because I am created in God's image. I am a new creation. I am redeemed, reconciled, restored. I am loved by a loving Father. I am a child of God. And if he is for us, what can mere mortals do to us? Let's pray. Lord, we just rejoice that we are your children and that you are a good, good Father. That you didn't call us just to follow you or to serve you as servants or slaves, but instead, Lord, you called us into relationship with you. that you called us into sonship with you to become heirs to your kingdom. And then when there was a price to pay for that sonship, you took it upon yourself to be bruised and beaten and tortured and hung on a cross so we didn't have to be. You spilled your blood so we didn't have to. And you paid the price so we didn't have to. And instead, all we have to do is say, yes, Lord, I will follow you. And I know it's not going to be perfect, but I'm going to follow you through any storm, knowing that you have me, you have my back, you will never leave me nor abandon me, but I am a child of God. And so we thank you for that, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jealous for me.
He loves us. We sing it, how he loves us. As you go out today, as you go out from here, don't just go out and go, okay, let's just sing, but I want you to go out and think about these four statements. As you wake up tomorrow, I want you to think about these four statements. I am created in God's image. I am a new creation. I am redeemed, restored, reconciled. I am loved by a loving Father, and I am a child of God. Think about those. When you wake up in the morning, think if you thought about that every morning, don't you think your attitude of the day may change a little bit? I know mine will. So our challenge for this week, even if you can only remember one, think of, I am a child of God. But every morning, wake up and just say to yourself, I am a child of God. Go out, have a great day, share the love of Jesus, go boldly and wonderfully, and be the children of God that you are. Have a great week. God bless you guys. Amen.